You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome back to The Individual in Society. Today's discussion will revolve around the family. My name is Sergio Soto, and again, thank you for joining us today. We are broadcasting live. This is our 12th session. There will be one more after this, and then, you know, this class will, you know, be over, and we'll resume sometime, you know, later next year. But anyway, especially, you know, with our topic today, and just like any topic, we welcome the community to call in, ask questions, share insight, and you can always call us in live at 800-339-1193, or you can write us at askdhtv@gmail.com. Now, with today's topic on the family, this is a topic that we all, you know, have something to contribute as far as the discussion goes. We all come from families, we all have a perspective on the family. And again, the family is the most basic institution in society. It's where primary socialization takes place. We learn about society, we learn norms, we learn about who we are and who others are through our, you know, families, right? You know, we've talked about how we form identities, the influence of that, of family units on that formation of identities. We discussed, you know, class, race, and gender. And again, family has a role to play in it, right? So, you know, this is a discussion I hope we all can reflect on and share different insights. And, you know, one of the more important things that we'll cover today, or at least discuss, are some of the myths associated with the family, right? You know, in our society, we tend to have this idea of what a perfect family is. And most families, most individuals would see themselves as dysfunctional or not fitting that norm. But again, you know, those ideas are for the most part, you know, something that's linked to ideology, social construction, just like anything else, and often a myth, especially when we think back about those good old days, you know, in the 60s, 50s, right? That supposedly every family matched up, you know, that Leave It to Beaver, you know, kind of era. And, you know, when we look back at that, we might think that, you know, there's so much discord, in society today, especially among the families, that we feel society might be headed down the wrong direction. But some of this stuff has existed since, you know, the start of human history. It's nothing new. And again, just like everything else in society, it's shifting, changing, and recreating itself. But we'll, again, discuss this as we go, and we'll question some of these underlying structures. So first, let's get some basic concepts down. We'll share a general definition of what the family is. The family, or a family, is a group of people. Again, a group of people directly linked by kin connections, adult members whom assume responsibility for the caring of children. Again, one of the reasons the family is seen as the most basic and important institution in society when it comes to creating a society is that, one, it creates people. Without people, you can't have a society. And those people learn inside the family. For instance, prior to this modern era where we are educated outside the home, most people, you know, and this is when, you know, society's dependent on the family based economy in order to survive. You know, most things were made at home or on, you know, where people lived and or grown there. You know, you would learn everything in those times, you know, from your family, right? What crops to grow, how to make certain items that are needed to survive, you know, what tasks, you know, were to be done at different times of the year. You know, this is part of that education. Nowadays, where it's kind of disconnected, we're disconnected from that. We go to experts. You know, it's much more, the division of labor is more pronounced in our society now. But, you know, that's just for instance. But still, you know, education takes place within the family. And again, you know, the creation of new people takes place inside, you know, these units of the family and maintaining them, right? Because again, you know, when we think about infancy and childhood, you know, children are for the most part pretty dependent on adults, especially in, Western society where an individual, you know, it's, you know, in our country, we can't, you know, an individual might not be allowed to work or, you know, be an economic engine till, you know, 15 years of age, and that's with the permit, right? So, I mean, kind of think about that, right? You know, and how, you know, we define our relationships according to that. So, as we said before, these are kin connections, so let's define kinship. Kinship is connections among individuals established through marriage or through lines of descendants that connect blood relatives, okay? So, you know, again, these are the connections, these are the bonds, by blood, it's, you know, sharing some DNA. Next, we have this concept of marriage. You know, many families are formed, or new families are formed under a marriage. You know, different lineages are brought together through a marriage. So marriage is a socially acknowledged, right? It has to, you know, meet certain defined terms in order to qualify as a marriage, right, legally, and socially acknowledged and approved sexual union between two adult individuals, right? You know, and that's our society. We're going to kind of break that apart, talk about different styles of marriages, safe sex marriages, as we move forward through this discussion. But again, you know, the marriage is, you know, a concept that was created. We'll explore why it's important and what role it serves. To a certain extent, you know, I want you to kind of think about how that feeds into the support and not only the nurturing, but the shepherding of a new life, a young child, into adulthood and the role a family plays in it, right? Because again, you know, the family is, you know, an economic unit. It shares responsibilities. It creates people and maintains them into the adulthood till, you know, they can, you know, start a family of their own. Some terms that we'll kind of use throughout this discussion or that you may have heard. One is the nuclear family. This is two adults living together in a household with their own or adopted children, right? And extended family. An extended family exists when close relatives, in addition to a married couple and children, live together in the same household or in a close continuous relationship, right? So what we're starting to establish are different parameters of what a family can be and who belongs to a family, right? So, you know, part of our discussion today is going to kind of take a historical look. You know, and we're going to kind of think about why the establishment of, of different norms regarding, you know, family were important, you know, not only with marriage, but, you know, we could think about the different statuses people can achieve, right? You know, achieve statuses like father, right? What defines a good father? What defines a bad father? You know, same thing with mother, what defines a good mother as opposed to a bad mother, right? You know, these good and bad, you know, are associated with behavior, roles, right? So again, you know, we're going to explore that normative side. To get some more definitions out of the way and to kind of think about, some of the underlying, structures or something like the patriarchy that, you know, dictates a family. You know, we're going to talk about the families of orientation or the families people are born into, right? The family that you're born into is, the family of procreation, right? That's where people are created. That's where you were created. A family into which one enters an adult within a new generation of children is brought up under. Actually, a family into which one enters as an adult within which a new generation of children is brought up. The family orientation is one you're born into. So I kind of misread my notes, but most of us will, again, be born into a family, learn the norms, learn about ourselves, be shaped by the family, and then we'll go off and start our own family, right, as adults, perhaps even have our own children, and we'll carry those same ideals and values with us, right? When we think about how norms are reproduced, right, why these cycles of, holding certain beliefs and values continue or when they're defeated, right? It's often through the family, right? You learn things. You learn how to see the world through the family. And when you have children, or if you have children, you'll repeat this behavior. You'll indoctrinate them with what you believe and what you think. Some more terms. Matrilocal. When a couple lives near or with a bride's parents. Or patrilocal. When a couple lives near or with a husband's parents. Now, in our society, in American society, we most of our families would be defined as neo-local, right? People couple up and they start their own home, their own family, outside of that family of orientation. But when it comes to matrilocal and patrilocal, this is what defined, human history. In some cultures, it's still very important, right? When people couple up, and we can assume that they're a heterosexual coupling, if a society's matrilocal, right, and usually there's a matriarchy in place, if it's matrilocal, the husband from that relationship will move to the wife's, to where the family lives, or if it's separated by time, or separate villages, for instance, the male will move into will leave his home and move into the wife's home, right? And again, American Indian culture, this is what tended to happen. In some respects, it makes more sense because, again, if you are going to rear children and you're responsible for them, and women tend to be the ones responsible for the rearing of children, you're going to need a lot, you're going to need help, you're going to need those bonds, and what better bonds to rely on than the ones you've spent your whole life developing and maintaining, right? Now, in patriarchal societies, you tend to see patrilocalism take place. This is where, again, in a heterosexual union, a wife and husband become are married, and the wife will leave the family of orientation to live with the male or the husband's family, right? So, if they're moving away to a new village or a new area and geographically separated, again, it benefits the male side of the family, because somewhere like in China, where there's a single child policy in place still for the most part, even though it's being relaxed, tradition holds that or the norms hold that the male child will take care of elderly parents. So since it's patrilocal there, a woman will be born into a family. Let's say she gets married. She will move away from her family of orientation. So it becomes very problematic for those, for her parents, because who's going to take care of them when they're older? Where, it benefits a family if they have a son, in that, if that son gets married, there's going to be an extra person to help with not only maintaining the land that they have or their family, but also those parents when they become elderly. So kind of the patriarchy at work and why it benefits it. So what we're going to start talking about next is how And again, I guess this is where it, you know, get really interesting, right? Is when we couple up, when we form families, especially when there's sex involved, you know, inside marriages, the norms that dictate it. Now, in our society, we view monogamy as, you know, the norm, or it's a it's a socially accepted practice. Individuals within relationships, you know, that are, you know, either sexually active or have the prospects of sex, you know, people observe monogamy, which is marriage, you know, marriage to only one individual at a time. But you know, monogamy, you know, goes past that. Even that, when you know, it isn't an explicitly sexual relationship, individuals only partner up with one other individual at a time. This is something people practice from, from when they first start dating. They may not have sex, but they expect their partners to be monogamous. This goes all the way into adulthood. Some marriages end in divorce because one of the partners chooses not to be monogamous. So this idea, this concept, although abstract, does dictate a lot of the, you know, family dynamics or interpersonal dynamics that take place within relationship, this concept of one partner at one time. So what we're gonna do next is we're gonna watch a short video titled Why Monogamy and How It's Changing. And then we'll be right back and we'll kind of open up the discussion, open up the phone lines, and taking some questions or comments from our audience. But again, we're going to talk about monogamy, how it works, its purpose, and then we'll be right back.
I'm here with Oprah. But she wanted to stay because it's such an interesting story.
Yes, I wanted to see what the results say.
Yes, scientists have long wondered why some mammals, including humans, are monogamous. Now, two new studies offer different answers, neither of which are based on romance. One says fathers stick around to protect their young from being killed. The other concludes animals paired off so males could guard their mates and claim their breeding rights. Dr. Steven Snyder is an associate clinical professor of psychiatry at the Mount Sinai Medical Center and a sex therapist. How are you? Good morning.
Very good. Thanks for having me.
Okay, two different sex studies.
Dr.
What
Snyder,
do they show?
Oprah. Oprah, Dr.
How do you
Snyder.
Do?
Yeah.
So what do we know now?
Well, we know that human monogamy is a drama that's been going on for a long, long time. Our predecessors we're apes.
Yeah.
And we're from the promiscuous part of the ape family, along with the chimpanzees and the bonobos. But there's no doubt about that, right?
No question.
You look on the news every day.
Yeah.
Lots of sleeping around in our part of the ape family. But about 4 million years ago, something happened. Probably because of the threat of infanticide. Fathers wanted to hang around and protect their children from rival males.
Okay, here's my problem with these studies,
is
that they're based on animals, not based on humans. That we're attributing what is animal behavior about monogamy to human beings.
Ah, that's the start of monogamy. We think the start of monogamy was 4 million years ago, not human beings yet. These are the relatives of chimps and bonobos that are going to eventually become human beings.
But can you just get to this question?
Yeah.
We as human beings, are we naturally monogamous? Or is Oprah's shaking her head no. Or is promiscuity in the DNA? Because I would like to think that...
I can answer that really quickly.
Okay.
We are not naturally monogamous. Okay?
You couldn't be.
That's
right.
What Oprah
said. So let me tell you more. Our foundation...
I don't want it to be so.
Well, we'll get there, okay? Our foundation...
Well, you can be.
Okay. Yes, I am.
Yes, and I expect my husband.
Yeah,
and I am too, but I'm just saying, for the species, it's not.
And I'm going to try and get you all there. I'm just going to show you how it happens, okay?
Okay.
We're not naturally monogamous. Our foundations are promiscuous because we're from the promiscuous part of the ape family with the bonobos and the chimpanzees. 4 million years ago, probably... I believe one of these studies about primates, it was probably to prevent infanticide, the fathers started to hang around. And there began to develop the beginnings of emotions that most of us rely on to keep families together. Possessiveness,
right.
Jealousy,
mm-hmm.
and once in a while, romantic love. Okay?
Charlie, you have an opinion on this?
I agree with Oprah on this. I mean, I think it's a natural instinct. And I think the thing that keeps you, those that don't, has to do with values and love and for the
absolutely.
People.
Absolutely.
What we want and what is the natural instinct.
They have to exert discipline because you obviously attracted to more than one person.
What did you say? What we want?
What you want, yes. And what is the natural order of things
exactly.
is very different.
Exactly.
Yeah.
All right. Dr. Stephen Snyder. I have to wrap. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming.
Yeah, great to
okay.
have you.
Okay.
That's what I was going to tell you, Dr. Snyder. This is
wow.
TV.
Okay, so welcome back right there. We learned a little bit about the possible inception of monogamy in, early human life. But again, over time, it becomes ritualized and institutionalized. And again, our phone lines are open. If you want to comment on this or maybe even reflect on whether monogamy is still something that we should observe in the modern world, right? Now, we're going to talk about why, it's important in culture, the norms behind it. But again, just like everything else, monogamy is a social construction, right? Whether or not it's natural, monogamy is not natural, right? Especially the values and norms associated with it, but they do serve a function. And over human history, societies have been held together, by this concept, right? And, it serves more than just a, role in deciding who partners up with whom sexually. Because oftentimes when we feel anger, jealousy, or mistrust with, a partner, whether it's a sexual relationship or not, it's often when, these exclusive rights that we have or believe we have become threatened, right? So, one way to kind of reflect on it is that, in the course of human history, it was very important for humans to know who were their biological children and whom they were going to not only expend their labor force to protect and ensure that they develop and had a reach adulthood, but also with the inception of private property, when people died off, who was gonna get their property once they no longer lived. Right? So to a certain extent, this is also connected to marriage, right? And this concept of virginity, right? In order to ensure that, men who, in most cultures came into power, owned property, the way they safeguarded their, genetic line is by policing the sexuality of women. And even commodifying it so that they could be, it could be society would observe virginity as a value and something that's linked to morality that would police not only the behavior of women but how women are seen in society. And this is something that exists today. But not only that, right? Families are economic units, units that support each other both emotionally and physically, right? In order to create some social order, monogamy plays a role in our society today, and it always has, whether it's to, rear a family or to, define ourselves in our relationships, right? So it's something to reflect on. So in our society, again, we only have one spouse at a time. There are laws that police this, but over the course of human history and in different cultures, there have existed variations. Polygamy is this variation, a marriage that allows a husband or a wife to have more than one spouse. Right. So more than one spouse, this is either a husband having multiple wives or a wife having multiple husbands, right? Polygyny is this, is the situation where a man may be married to more than one woman. And again, this is something that, you find across the world. It's something that at one time was the norm, right? And again, it's also associated with the ability for an individual to support a family. It was a, you know, it was linked to social status because, again, you know, this concept of romantic love that we talked about early on, and you know, the in your text, it's written about in the first chapter, is a new concept, right? Before then, you know, people married for status or, you know, for property, right? Dowries were something that was very common, and love was not the basis of most relationships. So, you know, if a person had multiple wives, it was because they could, again, you know, support, you know, those individuals. What we see as a rarity in society, but nonetheless exists, is this concept of polyandry, where a woman may have more than one husband, right? So what we're going to watch next is a short clip on a society, you know, that is that practices polyandry. You know, one that still exists today can be found in the Himalayas, in Nepal, in India, and that's what we're going to take a look at now. But again, you know, think about what the circumstances are, how it functions, you know, how this arrangement is something that's beneficial to the community in that particular climate and geographic area. You know, and you know, you might even ask yourself, is this a necessity, right? This is something the video is going to reflect on, and then we'll be right back and we'll talk about that in our own society when we return.
It's called polyandry, one woman, several husbands. It's an unusual arrangement. Today, polyandry only persists in isolated villages in the Himalayas. When it was time for Sunita Kumari to wed, her family, like many in India, made arrangements. But they involve more than a dowry and a celebration. Sunita has not one husband, not two husbands, but three, all brothers. What must her life be like? Westerners might find the practice shocking, but for this community, it works fine. One reason, sheer practicality. In the Himalayas, arable land is scarce. Farms are tiny. If each generation divided each family's holdings, everyone would starve. Polyandry preserves the farm and the family's future. Unlike most men in India, husbands here handle domestic duties. They're willing to help with the cooking and childcare. In fraternal polyandry, a family picks a wife for its oldest son. The marriage can also include his younger brothers. They don't have to join in, but most do.
No one takes a decision regarding one's own marriage. Everyone at home sits down together, and then it is decided with the consent of everyone.
Polyandry also functions as a form of birth control. No matter how many husbands she has, a wife can get pregnant only so often. If each man were to wed separately, the population here would explode. But what about sex, the forbidden core of the polyandry taboo? In truth, it's a matter of scheduling, and on the wife's part, forbearance.
Tolerance is very important. The wife has to understand everything. The older brother's nature, the younger brother's nature.
What about jealousy, that bane of even the most mundane marriage?
If the wife is smart, she will take turns each night to sleep with all the brothers. It's not like the older brother wants her the whole time.
Until recently, no one here much cared what the outside world thought. Isolation had preserved a way of life that had withered everywhere else. But a road now links the region to distant cities. And on roofs, once decorated only with prayer flags, satellite dishes sprout. This village has entered the modern world, whose images of romance stand in sharp contrast to polyandry. But polyandry here faces a bigger threat, education.
As more people are becoming more educated, we are also practicing family planning. If a father has only one son, there will be no question about the land. Therefore, common marriages will come to an end.
In two, perhaps three generations, polyandry may vanish here. But for now, those who practice it find comfort in the familiar.
I myself feel that common marriage is very good. I feel like everyone should live like our family. Even if we do not have anything to eat or drink, we sit happily, we live peacefully.
Welcome back. So there we see, again, an example of polyandry. You can feel in and feel free by calling in to, you know, share your perspective, a comment, what, you know, share what you see, what you believe, or, you know, anything that you want to connect to these concepts that we've been discussing today. Now, again, you know, whether it's monogamy, polygamy, or polyandry, you can argue, one can argue that, you know, each in themselves has a function inside their respective societies. One, it creates social order. It's a byproduct of both natural and economic circumstances. For instance, in the video we just watched where people practice polyandry, you know, a living, you know, at the base or, you know, on a mountain in the Himalayas is a very hard and rough life, right? So not only is there a scarcity of people, but, you know, it might take more resources and more labor to raise, you know, a family. So if it's done collectively, you know, within the situation, you know, it might make more sense, you know, for that society. Additionally, you know, you might want to, you know, kind of reflect on why it might be important, or one of the functions was that, you know, a wife would enter a marriage with sets of brothers, right? You know, genetically, maybe the offspring wouldn't, you know, be in, you know, one wouldn't be able to differentiate, you know, the offspring very, easily. And if, if the wife is involved with, you know, all the brothers, you know, it's, you know, one brother can't tell, you know, whether that's their son or daughter from another. And again, you know, the same genetic line continues, and that's, you know, what's somewhat important to, you know, humans, right? Additionally, you know, the fact that the land wouldn't have to be divided up also became something that, was central to this society. But again, you know, it creates a social order. In our society, monogamy creates a social order. It's a basis of what most of us will see or choose to practice in our own relationships. We can also kind of bring into question whether, you know, although something like polygamy is outlawed, you know, we might have de facto versions of polygamy. For example, you know, if someone's polyamorous, has several partners, children may be produced, you know, with different partners. We have this, you know, in our society, we have terms that we, you know, some of us know, like babies' daddies and babies' mamas, right? You know, some celebrity figures or sports figures have, you know, children with different partners, right? You know, is it more, is it really more problematic that, you know, people have children within a marriage or have multiple wives or husbands, you know, legally? Or again, by de facto, some people in our society practice this, but they do it outside of marriage. So we have a couple comments that, have come in, and we'll go through them. Katie writes in, it is interesting today to note that as many parents age, they are now dependent on their children for care or a place to live. We see this role reversal for so much, reversal so much today for economic reasons. And that's very true, Katie. You know, in our society, we often, you know, the practice is to, you know, cast away someone, you know, well, okay, well, since we leave our family, we're neo-local, I would actually contend that it's much more problematic for our elderly population because they're seen as independent from their children often. And, you know, that's why, you know, so many people end up in, you know, homes for the elderly or senior communities and you know, to that extent. Another thing, you know, we can reflect on collectively is, you know, the fact that, you know, I would actually point out that more young people are, you know, living longer with their parents, right? Into their late 20s and 30s because of the economic circumstances that are at play right now. You know, in some countries, it's much more severe than in the United States. But again, you know, the age at which a person can move out is often tied to economic reasons. Like, for example, some of you may be planning to move out or have moved out and live independently from your families, right? Think about what is necessary for that to happen, right? Usually a good job or a stable stream of income. If that's not present, then, you know, individuals will still be dependent on their parents. And, you know, one of the things, the phenomena that has occurred because of the economic crisis is that when some of these folks go off to college, they live independently, they finish college, they graduate the degree, they end up coming back home and having to live with their parents till they get their feet on the ground or establish a place for themselves to live on their own. Again, it's problematic because, again, you know, the economy isn't as fruitful as it once was. Wages aren't as high, and, you know, rent, you know, is expensive, especially in a big city like Los Angeles or elsewhere. So, you know, more people are forced back into to live with their parents after they finish college or because of the economy, right? Generations that had a chance to, you know, establish themselves or had a different economy to work with, one that, you know, for some individuals, they were able to, you know, graduate high school and then find a job and then buy a house in which, you know, back, you know, for a while that was affordable or something that people could do, you know, they have, that wealth to depend, you know, to tap. They have, you know, they have that established. So, you know, parents might be in a better position today than their children were. You know, something else to reflect on. Julianne writes in, why exactly has virginity gone from being valued to being a mere idea that is considered to be very rare? Is this a sociological issue? It is. It's a sociological issue because, you know, something like the concept of virginity is something that dictates human behavior, how people see themselves or, you know, how they feel. And again, it's, you know, oftentimes in our society, it's linked to morality when it really shouldn't. Some books or things you might want to check out independently. There's a book called The Virginity Myth and also, you know, some lectures on it online. But again, you know, something like this concept of virginity is not only linked to religion, but also at one time served a purpose in, you know, the founding of society. You know, if we want to be critical about it, you know, it benefits men, right? Men's sexuality isn't policed the same way women's sexuality is. For instance, you know, if a woman has multiple partners, certain language that we might use to defame her, or, society really goes into the practice of degrading women who have, you know, multiple partners. Whereas if a male has, you know, and again, this is, you know, considering that, you know, these are heterosexual individuals. If a heterosexual male has multiple female partners, you know, there's terminology that, you know, bestow a high status on this male, you know, like stud and, you know, things of that nature. You know, even a movie some of you may have watched, you know, called, Easy A, something like that, you know, kind of outlines this norm in society, this value in society and how it can shape a young woman's perspective of not only herself, but of society as a whole, right? So again, something like virginity is extremely problematic. Now, with this concept of it being just, I guess, symbolic or an idea that doesn't have as much weight, you know, part of it is, you know, has to do with, you know, the, you know, sexual revolution, women, you know, emancipating their sexuality. But at the same time, you know, it's somewhat problematic as well, because in our society, which is a very commercial one, sexuality is used to sell all kinds of things. It's something that is central to, you know, young people and how they define and see themselves, especially young males. And, you know, to a certain extent, it can be commodified and objectified and leads to other problems inside society, right? And when we think about our society and how it's linked to rape culture, you know, this objectification within the male gaze is, you know, something that leads to violence against women. But, you know, this is something that we touched on lightly during our discussion on gender inequality. If you have further questions, feel free to call in, write in, and we'll see if we can't tackle them. What we're going to shift to now is are some of the theoretical perspectives on the family. And again, if you want to call in, write in, you can reach us at 800-339-1193, or you can write in at askdhtv@gmail.com. And, you know, from now to about 4:29, we'll be fielding questions. So theoretical perspectives on the family. So functionalism, right? This is the concept where, you know, society is sort of like an organism. It's interrelated. It's interdependent, right? Everything has a manifest function, a latent function. And then when it doesn't work, it has a latent function. So the family, the function of the family is to serve as a place to not only rear children, to ensure their survival, and to, in order to have them take their role when they reach adulthood as, you know, the basis of society, right? You know, within the economy, within, you know, every, you know, institution inside society. You know, it's not only that, but it's also, again, where socialization takes place. So primary socialization, right? This is the process by which children learn the cultural norms of society into which they are born, right? So through this socialization, again, people not only learn their social position, what behavior is acceptable or not acceptable, about, you know, themselves, gender, how society sees it, right? You know, it also serves as a place where personality stabilization takes place. So the role of the role that the family plays in assisting adult family members emotionally, right? So the family, you know, has a very important, you know, place, right? You know, Talcott Parsons, you know, in the 50s and 60s got a lot of criticism directed at him because of his work on the traditional family, especially from feminists. Because, again, you know, the way he argued it was that, again, and this is covered in your text, is that, you know, males and females were both equipped with different, you know, virtues that allowed them to perform certain tasks better than the other. And throughout history, you know, was ritualized and institutionalized. Men became, you know, the purveyors of, you know, work outside the home, and women became the purveyors of work inside the home, right? They were better equipped to rearing children, so therefore, you know, through this process, you know, over a long period of time, you know, women were, you know, subjugated to this, right? So from this perspective, you know, even though gender norms can cause, you know, are rooted in inequality, they do still serve a function. But again, you know, as most basic, you know, we can, you know, if you're a functionalist, you can cast that part aside partially. You know, the family is a place where we learn about society, about norms, who we are. Again, it's where primary socialization takes place. That's not to say, again, you know, to remind you about our discussion on socialization, it's the only place socialization takes place, but, you know, that all, the rest of that falls into secondary socialization. So from a very early age, you're taught, again, your gender, identity, your role in society, about society, what norms and values, or sometimes we call it manners, are to be observed. Now, from a feminist perspective, the family is the locus of exploitation, loneliness, and profound inequality. Okay? Now, within the traditional family and, even the history here in the United States, women have served a servantile role within the family. The work done inside the home was often, is very laborious, but often doesn't receive the same kind of prestige that, work outside the home does. It's devalued, right? So, when we think about inequality or some of these things, it's about, the expectations, right? Like, for instance, because of these norms, if they're rigidly observed, the best people, people's agency is usurped, right? If you're a woman, when these roles were very strict and very rigid, you may have not been allowed to explore your own ability and agency inside a profession or work outside the home. Or if you were male and wanted to stay at home, rear children, and you felt that you were best equipped to do that, again, you run into another set of norms that may chastise you. And again, we deal with this even today, right? As we move forward, we'll explore more of this, but it's problematic. So this struggle included issues of gender power, emotional care of the family members, and again, the domestic division of labor, which when we, discuss gender inequality, we learn that not only, are women expected to do more of the everyday chores, right? Everyday duties that it takes to maintain a household, right? They don't have as much power as their male counterparts. To continue with the story, during the 1970s and 80s, these perspectives dominated research agendas of the feminist writers that argued unequal power relationships made certain family members benefited more than others. And since this is a patriarchal society, the way the gender division of labor works inside the family, it really privileges men over women, right? Men, because they are linked to working outside the home, are called the breadwinners, the foundation of the family. They have more social status than their female counterparts. But again, most of the labor, most of the child rearing, most of the heavy lifting is done by women. But that's not to say that, if you're a woman and you want to raise your children, that you should be absolved from that, or you can't do that, or it's a step back for the independence of women as a whole. But just understand that for many women, historically, this is something that was placed on them, a duty that was placed on them, something that they had no power over, and they were constricted to these roles. Now, if you want to do that today and it's your own choice, more power to you. But if you don't, right, again, that's something that we want to reflect on and, encourage individuals to maximize their agency and opportunity. Now, as you move forward to this discussion, and when we, now we're going to start discussing something, the reality of working mothers today, we're going to go ahead and break for about 39 seconds and watch learn about some statistics about women and, mothers as top earners now, right? If women are earning more than their male counterparts, in a marriage, more than their husbands or their spouse, right? How is that going to change the dynamics of the family or the power relationships within it? So let's take a look at that now, and then we'll be right back.
Poll shows how important working women have become in America. The Pew Research Center says a woman provides the number one source of income in 40% of households with children. Nearly two-thirds of those breadwinners are single mothers. The rest are wives with children who earn more than their husbands. The poll finds those Two-income families have the largest incomes of all families. Half of them earn more than $80,000 a year. And Charlie, this new study is so interesting because in 1960, it was just 11% of women were the bread earners. Now it's a record 40% of households. It's part of the changing landscape
Indeed.
In America.
It sure is.
Okay, so 40% compared to 11% in the past, right? More women are entering the workforce. Society is depending far more on them to, let me take a step back. In actuality, in today's economy, you know, dual incomes are something that's a reality, something most people will have to undertake in order to maintain the standard of living that most people accept as the norm. So, you know, this is, again, shifting how we understand work inside and outside the family, and again, shifting some of these obligations. But again, we're going to kind of focus on some of the inequalities at work. So, again, for the most part, we've been exploring the family, how it's linked to the larger social structure. But, you know, we're going to take some time to kind of think about the second shift again. This term, the second shift, reflects on the fact that working women often are, expected to not only work a full shift outside the home, 8 hours or 6 hours, whatever it may be, but once they get off of that job, they have to go home and tend to the needs of the family, right? And this is another source of inequality. It creates more stress for women. But again, the second shift is something that is a burden that both, male and female members of a family should undertake. Now, it does become problematic when, it's a single mother or a single parent household. We'll talk about, hopefully if we have enough time, about single parent homes. But again, one of the benefits from it is that often children from single parent homes will be more independent and have more skills, domestic skills, than their counterpart to have two parents. Because again, if you're a single parent child, you'll have more obligations, whether it's to clean your own laundry, wash your own laundry, make dinner, tend to your own needs, etc., because your parent may not be able to. Now, quick history. Actually, what we'll do is we'll briefly talk about the history of the family, how it's changed, right? Especially, how we see childhood today. And, that's something that we're going to kind of lean on a little bit. So the development of the family from the 1600s to 1700s, has shifted and is very different from what it is today. Families used to be very authoritarian, unemotional institutions that were concentrated on the community and on other kin, right? The focus wasn't on the family, as an independent inner sanctum itself. We can see this when we see the experience of a child. The way we see childhood today, or even adolescence, is something that is carefree. A time when children are to be showered with kindness and love. That's something that didn't take place, within these early families prior to the Industrial Revolution or even during the Industrial Revolution. This concept of childhood is something that's relatively new. What took place, though, is that, children were treated as little adults, right? They had responsibilities. They were, again, times were very authoritarian. They were, subjected to the same discipline that adults were, right? Nowadays, that's changed a lot. Children, are seen as something that we protect, nurture, and care for. The circumstances under which people were married was different too, right? For the most part in human history, marriages were not something based on love or this romantic idea of love, but instead economical or political unions, right? People were married off to individuals who were economically stable or who met the approval of of the different families negotiating this, right? For many cultures, it was, you know, it was a dowry was necessary. You know, this is a gift or a fee that was paid for a bride. Now, you know, with the rise of the Industrial Revolution, you know, this started to change. You know, men began to work. They, for the most part, were independent from, the need to, rely on their parents economically, and therefore they could make their own choices. So they themselves would, you know, collect enough money to either pay the dowry or court the women and, use their own economic wealth to fund this endeavor, if you will. But now today, again, you know, with, you know, more with the independence of both men and women, and, you know, we see love as the basis, right? So this is a big, you know, historical shift that began, you know, in the this last century, right? This concept that you marry because you like someone, that you're attracted to them, that you're emotionally bonded with them, right? This is, you know, now again the basis of it. But one of the things that we can point out and that you can ask yourself or comment on is that, you know, when you or when society, you know, dictates who people should partner up with, you know, is it still all that far removed? By that I mean when people partner up or when they look for prospective partners, they, consider not only the, you know, emotional, physical side of, you know, what people, assess as love, but also the economical side, the fact that of whether an individual can provide a stable, financially stable or economically sound surrounding, whether that partner is, you know, has a viable future. You know, those things don't change all that much over time. You know, when we, you know, if you list what your needs are, right? Oftentimes in coupling, it's about meeting those needs, whether they're emotionally, physical, or financial. But anyway, you know, this is, part of history again. You know, this is, you know, the third phase, you know, that your book will refer to is this personal selection, again, guided by sexual attraction and romantic love. And again, first started in the 18th century, but really was, began to spread across the world during the, you know, last century. Now let's talk about some of the myths of the family, okay? We tend to see the family as a place that is a safe harbor, if you will, a safe haven. And, the truth is, for some individuals, you know, it may be the most violent and unsafe place inside, in all of the world, right? And we think about the family as, as a haven. We think, again, you know, it's full of love, but again, you know, families can be very violent, and that's something that we'll talk about as we move forward. Another myth is that, you know, families are, you know, separated from other institutions as a whole. And again, you know, if anything in this course and all of sociology, you should understand that just like anything else, you know, society influences the family. The different institutions within society influence the family. For example, the economy. Economic factors have a great influence on what happens within the family. Not only its viability and its ability to care and shape the lives of children, but even the relationships of those adults within it. You know, some folks divorce because of money. You know, whether it's, you know, usually because there's a scarcity. People plan, you know, having children, you know, based on economic factors or even where you live, right? You know, the neighborhood you live in is, again, based on class. So all of those factors, you know, as subtle as they are, you know, are beyond or outside of the family as a whole. You know, you can nurture, love each other as much as possible, but you know, they may, you know, that might not pay the bills. Another institution is something like education, right? Even though primary socialization takes place inside the home, inside the family, secondary socialization is something that competes with some of those ideas and beliefs, right? The ways you raise your children, or if you have children, or if you plan to have children, you have to consider the messages and influences are going to emerge from outside the home, within the media, within peer groups, within the institution of education. You know, how are you going to confront these social shifts, right? So, you know, these are some of the few ones. You know, another one is that, you know, we often, you know, I think the book refers to, you know, we reflect on this myth of family always being a tranquil, harmonious place, right? Within it, you know, this Ozzie and Harriet path, something akin to Leave It to Beaver, you know, where things in the past were much simpler and perfect. But the truth is, you know, when we think about the past, it's a very selective memory, right? Oftentimes people are worried that, you know, children are having, you know, sex at an earlier age, a greater frequency, and people worry about premarital sex leading to teen pregnancies. And that source, you know, something like teen pregnancy is actually down, you know, from the 60s and 50s, right? You know, people are much more open about sexuality now, but, you know, with that, you know, comes a lot of folks, you know, being more aware of the precautions that they can take. But again, you know, that runs into issues of morality and whatnot. Kathy writes in, I've heard many adults say that it is much more difficult for a child to be a child today. We have so many more things to worry about, mostly safety issues. And again, you can call in 800-339-1193 or write in at askdhtv@gmail.com if you would like to comment or share your perspective as well. And yeah, Katie, you know, many people worry and have always worried about the safety of their child. You know, there's more attention or more information sources on some of the things that can happen to children, like violence against children, or, you know, the fact that some children are preyed upon. But in actuality, again, you know, some of this stuff has always existed. It was called different things at different times, or the same kind of stigmas weren't attached to it, right? If anything, you know, the fact was that, you know, not as much media attention was given to these, you know, phenomenons, right? Now, it's always problematic when we look at the past and try to look at, you know, for some of these instances, because, again, you know, the research wasn't there yet or wasn't investigating this, but, you know, we do know, you know, things like, violence against children, whether it's physical, sexual, mental, you know, existed, right? And it continues to exist. And, you know, just to kind of reflect on this a little deeper, you know, even within our own society, right? Certain instances of violence receive more attention than others, right? Like, for instance, you know, school shootings in, you know, upper middle class neighborhoods, you know, tend to resonate within the media, the institution of the media, and it seemingly affects, you know, everybody, you know, in the nation. But again, you know, some of that stuff has occurred in, you know, areas that aren't so prominent, that are areas that are socioeconomically deprived, or to, you know, people who have been victimized, you know, but ignored because of the color of skin or social class, right? So again, you know, these are things that have existed and things that we should keep in mind. You know, but yeah, I mean, it's a very good point. You know, the family is connected to it. The role of the family is to protect the younger individuals and socialize them and give them the tools to reach adulthood and be successful within society. But again, some of the things don't change. There are some things that make it more difficult. I would, you know, point to economic changes, but again, you know, this argument that culture or that society is going to the proverbial hell in a handbasket is, this, you know, is an argument that has existed for centuries. The truth is, you know, we always feel threatened because society constantly changes And we're made aware of these changes almost on a daily basis now today, right? Technology keeps taking leaps and bounds. You know, so much of it changes so rapidly. You know, the experiences of even you all as children will not be the same as, you know, children being born, you know, today, right? You'll look back and, you know, they have access to, you know, things like the internet. For instance, you know, something like the internet, you know, like when we think about human sexuality, you know, people have always explored sexuality, have always had to a certain extent access to, pornographic media, whether it's images or stories or things of that nature. But, you know, something like the internet has changed how people experience, you know, their sexuality to a greater extent, right? If anything, you know, I think it's Cheryl Truckle who, you know, has a book called, Together Alone or something to that effect. You know, she writes about this and, you know, she points out that most of our, you know, first sexual experiences will be, as, you know, people in society, as, you know, young people emerge, most of their sexual experience will be, you know, shared alone. Won't be shared. It'll be experienced alone, probably in front of a computer screen or some kind of digital device. So something to reflect on. So as we move forward, we're going to switch over to our next topic, which is marriage, right? The basis of families. So we're going to pose this question. We're going to watch a short video on why are fewer Americans getting married, right? Or pursuing a marriage, which is, you know, one of the trends that we see today. You know, part of it might be the, it being destigmatized, or, you know, the fact that people are, you know, cohabiting together rather than, being married first, right? The circumstances have changed over time. So we'll take a few minutes to watch this, and then we'll be right back and continue our discussion on the family.
And finally tonight, our second story on the shifting trends in American life. This one's about the changing demographics of marriage. Ray Suarez has our conversation.
For decades, the fact that a sizable majority of Americans were married shaped our politics, where we lived, where we worked, and what we thought when we heard the word family. Recently, the Pew Research Center took a look at all of us over 18 and found just 51% are married, down from more than 70% in 1960. Stephanie Kuntz has been chronicling the changes in American marriage for a long time. She teaches history and family studies at Evergreen State College in Washington and is director of research at the Council on Contemporary Families. Professor Kuntz, welcome. We moved in 50 years from almost three quarters of married adults to barely half. What happened? What's pushing those numbers?
Well, one of the things that you have to bear in mind is that 1960 was probably the most atypical year in 150 years. The age of marriage was at an all-time low. Half of all women were married before they got out of their teens, and the rate of marriage was at an all-time high. So what's happened since then, primarily what's driving this is the rise in the age of marriage. It's now up to 26 for women and 28 for men. And that's actually a good thing, because the longer a woman delays marriage, right up into her early 30s, the lower her chances of divorce. But it does totally change the social weight of married households in our economy, our society, our politics.
But not only has the age at first marriage risen, which of course that's just math, it makes a smaller number of adults married, but the number of people who have ever been married has also declined. Has marriage moved from being sort of culturally mandatory to more optional?
Well, it's definitely moved to being more optional. That does not mean, though, that it's not just as valued, in fact, even more valued than it used to be. And it doesn't mean that the majority of Americans will not marry. I think that probably we're going into a situation where a slightly larger number of people will never marry than in the past, maybe 15%, as opposed to 10% norm and 5% in the atypical 1950s. And of course, we also have some people who will live alone after considered divorcing. But on the other hand, people are marrying for the first time in their 40s, 50s, and 60s at older ages than ever before. So for me, the main thing that I think we're facing here is that you can no longer assume that married couple households are going to be the main places where people make the major life decisions, whether that's entering into becoming sexually active, buying a house, entering long-term obligations, living with somebody that is a romantic partner, even having a child out of marriage. So we can no longer assume that married couple households are the only place where people incur obligations, make commitments, and need help in meeting their obligations.
Well, you've talked about these big life moments, but have they responded to the fact that marriage has changed in this way over the last 50 years? Our tax laws, the way we build houses, the way we award property in courts, all kinds of things are still built around marriage.
Absolutely, absolutely. Just look at work-family policies that just assume that it's only married couples who are going to have children, that just ignore the fact that singles also have responsibility for aging parents. There are so many ways in which we are still acting as though American families were like 1950s sitcoms. Instead of the tremendous diversity, most people will marry in America, but most people will spend substantial portions of their adult life outside marriage. It's a more fluid situation than it used to be. They'll move through. They may cohabit for a while. They may get married. They may get divorced. So these are the sorts of things that our social policy and even our emotional expectations of family life have to catch up with these changing realities.
Along with the long-term trends, there are some short-term ones too. The number of newlyweds is way down. Is that going to push that 50% threshold down so that married people are a minority of American adults?
It may. It depends how long this recession and the aftermath of the recession lasts. This is a long-term trend, the decline in the proportion of married couples in the population, but it's been definitely, I think, exacerbated by the recession. But on the other hand, we may see some bounce back after that, as we have in previous recessions and depressions when the marriage rate fell.
How is who gets married shaped by income, education, factors like that?
Well, one of the things we're seeing is a tremendous class divide in the access to stable, satisfying relationships, whether married or cohabiting. And the marriages of college-educated couples have been getting more and more stable. The divorce rates have been falling. But that's not so for high school dropouts and even increasingly for high school-educated couples. It seems that one of the issues going on here is that we expect more of marriage than ever before, both as an economic partnership and as an emotional partnership. And as it becomes possible, or less possible, to count on a man having a steady job. The real wages of high school graduates today are $4 an hour lower in constant dollars than they were back in 1970. They're much more likely to experience job insecurity, much less likely to have pensions. So a woman, a low-income woman, making a decision about marrying such a man has to figure out, well, what are the benefits of this as compared to the possibility that we might divorce in the future, or as compared to what would happen if I invested in my own education and earnings power. And so I do think we're seeing a class divide that's quite troublesome. I think that it partly reflects growing economic inequality in our society, but of course it exacerbates it as well.
Stephanie Kuntz, thanks for joining us.
Okay, welcome back. So again, if you want to call in, write in, and share some of your perspectives or even give your opinion on whether marriage is an option today or not, you know, feel free to call in at 800-339-1193 or write in at askdhtv@gmail.com. So, we see a couple numbers there, 51%, marriage rate. But again, keep in mind that about 90% of individuals in our society will become married at some point in their life. Has our perspective or how we see marriage changed all that much? Is it still as valuable? Is it still as sacred? Or, what are the circumstances, guide the norms of when people should get married or who, if they should even get married, right? or what the function of marriage is, right? Is it merely for economic, stability and safety, or is it much deeper, right? We can surely say it's much deeper as in, as far as emotional circumstances, but is a marriage necessary to have that, right? Can you cohabitate and, support each other, can a couple support itself, outside of marriage, right? Is it only the symbolism that remains? But anyway, comment that came in, Madeline writes in, I've seen the effects of the economy on a daily firsthand basis. My father is not with us often as he works hard and to barely provide. This pressure creates tension between my parents is unnecessarily affecting my siblings as well. As we saw in our news piece, economic circumstances shape not only when people get married, but how they reflect and see their marriage as either fruitful or burden or as a burden, right? Something like economic prosperity can be a very good deodorant for other problems that exist within the family, right? But let's, again, think about the different circumstances at work. Young people are waiting longer to get married before they get married, right? They put it off, right? This is a big change from, the 1950s where, the average ages were, 18 for women and 20 for men. To today where the number gets pushed up, every couple of years, to something like 26 for men and 24 years of age for women. So one of the things that we have to question is, okay, what's going on? What changed, right? One of the things that explains why men and women wait longer to get married, maybe even to their late 20s, is that, oftentimes, you have to think about what happens right after people graduate high school or at the age of 18. People are pursuing careers, pursuing getting their education. After they get their education, they sign up or find a job. They work that job for a little while before they really settle down and, become married. The other side of it is, again, in order to have, access to sex, there's another way to really put it, but in order to be sexually active, one no longer has to be, or it's not the same norms guiding sexuality aren't linked with marriage being a married union being the only place an individual can have intercourse. Right, that's changed too. So, there's less of a pressure for individuals to pursue that. Some of the interesting, stats that come out, the younger you get married, the higher the probability of a divorce, the higher the probability of experiencing a divorce. Right, one of the things that leads to divorce is, just people get tired of each other or, feel that they haven't really lived. But again, money matters, things of that nature do have, an influence on how people see their marriage, right? The other part that gets brought up is this concept of cohabitating, people living with each other, as an alternative to marriage or to, before marriage. One of the interesting things that often comes out from the studies of cohabitation and marriage is that when people cohabitate, it doesn't necessarily mean that they'll have a more fruitful marriage, right? For instance, the common sense logic that exists within society that is somewhat wrong or skewed is that if people cohabitate before, they become married or get married, their union would be stronger because they, again, had time to, figure out whether or not they are meant for each other. The truth is that, if anything, the evidence points slightly to a higher risk of getting divorced if people cohabitate for a long period of time. Again, this concept is rooted with, these facts suggest that, you know, perhaps people get tired of each other, or couples have problems prior to their marriage, but somehow figure out or equate their problems to the fact that they're not married, right? The same thing can happen when people have children. You know, children having babies can, you know, changes lives drastically for the most part. But, you know, it's kind of unpredictable what will happen as far as the dynamics within a family when a child is born. Some people will be pushed apart because of the duties and circumstances, and stresses that are associated with having a child. And some people will be pulled together. Or some couples will have no change, right? That's one of the, you know, the interesting things that's associated with it. Again, people are waiting longer to get married. People are getting married at older ages as well. But at the same time, you know, there's more people today living alone, right? This is due to divorce or separation, right? Or the high levels of divorce and separation. And, you know, one of the other interesting things is that women are having children at an older age. You know, when you plan to have children, or whether people plan to have children, is often, you know, something that's linked to where they are as far as their career or their economic stability. You know, with the economic, collapse in 2008, we saw some interesting things happen, like the birth rate, you know, slowed down or fell, right? For the most part, overall. But in some communities, you know, we see the rise of teen pregnancies with economic stagnation. You know, that's one of the things that's linked to it. So we'll take a quick look at the links between family, race, ethnicity, and the American family. Asian American families are characterized by dependence on a extended family, right? To a certain extent, you know, the success of newly immigrated is somewhat linked to this. And this allows higher incomes, and, you know, we also see lower fertility rates and low divorce rates within the Asian American community. Native American families are characterized, again, by tight kinship ties. There's a high rate of intermarriage, but there's also a high divorce rate. Latino families have a great diversity. Families tend to have generational households, high birth rates, and, you know, Mexican, Cuban, and Puerto Ricans make up the three largest groups within this category of Latino. African American families have a high rate of childbearing outside of marriage and are less likely to ever marry. There's more female-headed households within this community, but with multiple family members often existing in the childcare. So within each of these, you know, minority groups, we see, you know, things that are linked to strategies, culture, strategies as far as economic strategies, you know, maintaining strong kinship ties or intergenerational or a dependence on family members for the care of children is often linked to, you know, economic uncertainty or, you know, lower economic status, but also, you know, the cultural obligations that many people feel, you know, within their own particular group, right? You know, those ties tend to be stronger, you know, how people perceive family, it's taken much more differently. When we think about class may actually determine family patterns more than race and ethnicity. But again, you know, the empirical data is too sparse to, you know, significantly say so. Working families, may lack resources to enrich their children's lives. We kind of talked about this when we talked about class, right? If obviously if you have more opportunity, more economic stability, you know, you can offer your kids, you know, or children, families can offer their children more opportunities that are in line with, the cultural hierarchy at work in our society. Now, before we go, we'll talk a little, we'll discuss a little bit about divorce and separation, right? You know, there's a wide, there's many reasons why divorce takes place. You know, some are economical. You know, some people point to the economics of it. Some folks point to the relaxation of norms and morals within our society, right? But divorce is something that, again, is much more acceptable in our society. It's something that, you know, people often will turn to now if, again, they feel that their marriage isn't fruitful. And even the reasons people get divorced, you know, are linked to how individuals see themselves in society or how we see relationships as something that not only has to be emotionally and economically, you know, something that has to be emotionally and economically stable and fruitful, right? So again, as we said before, premarital cohabitation may lead to higher divorce rate. Doesn't necessarily mean that you will have a happier marriage if you live with someone before you get married. You know, this might surprise some folks. If your parents, parental divorce is also a factor. People whose parents divorce are more likely to divorce, right? Again, you know, the way people see that social bond shifts, it's much more elastic. Premarital childbearing, people who marry after having children are more likely to be divorced, right? You know, chances are the circumstances under which they have children aren't planned, so, you know, people might feel that they're forced into. Or marriage at an early age, again, teenagers who become married, you know, change over time. They may not have the same values that they have as the years go on. They may feel that they've left part of their lives unlived. Childless marriages, couples who without children are more likely to divorce, right? The presence of children inside a family is something that, you know, holds these families together. But again, it's difficult to gauge whether bad marriages necessarily are the only factors that lead to divorce, whether it's economic or whether it's just something that, you know, people just get tired of each other. You know, no one single cause is, you know, to blame. You know, some folks do point out to some of the, legislative changes where no-fault divorces are becoming more popular. This, to a certain extent, is that you can individuals can file for divorce, without really having any, reason other than people, the couple or someone in the partnership no longer wants to be married, right? So it's really no one's fault. So, you know, one of the arguments is that, the ease of getting divorced has been, facilitated by the state. Now, for the last few seconds, I guess I just want to reflect on, marriages are contracts, whether it's same sex or heterosexual, homosexual, or anything. You know, they're contracts that are created to ensure the viability of unions that may support children, unions that will support individuals, and, it's to protect shared interests or individual interests, within the law, especially when people buy property and whatnot. But that's it for today. We'll have another broadcast next week, and that'll be it. So long for now. And again, this has been the, Sociology 101, the individual and society.